Hello, I'm Greg Boyd with HistoryGeo.com, and we're here to talk about our antique maps project, what we call ZAM here at the office, the Z standing for zoomable, zoomable antique or historical maps. And we're going to go through a lot of information today, but I'm going to try to do it fairly quickly. So before we get started, I want to show you a couple of new things, that new ways that you can stay informed about all the new content and tools that we're putting online on a weekly basis. This is our brand new blog. It is going online as we speak. So by the time you go to this website at blog.historygeo.com, which there'll be a link at the homepage for you to see, for you to be able to click on and get to this through the homepage. By the time you get there, there'll be a couple of new posts on there. We're going to use this to show you advanced techniques and how to use the service, but also how to have a lot of fun making historical discoveries about people, whether they're in your family or people you're searching, or having to do with the ancestors of celebrities or politicians or criminals or any number of people that are in the news or have been in the news in times past. So we're going to have a lot of fun with this. I'm really excited about it. So please check this often. I'm going to close that and show you our Facebook page. We've only started this in the last couple of months, maybe longer than that. Not very long. We're just now starting to really use it and excited about this. And hope you'll go on Facebook. Click a like on our page. What that's going to do is give you the very most up-to-date alerts to new content and to new blog entries and the kinds of things we're discovering, or the kinds of discoveries that are being made in using our service. So we hope you'll join us on Facebook. Getting into the topic at hand, our antique maps project. For those of you who have used our First Landowners Project, what we've really been known for up to this point, this is going to be a departure from that. First Landowners Project is a single layer of millions and millions of original landowners in the continental United States, whereas the antique maps collection could be anywhere, and it could be landowners and it might not be landowners. There really are no limits, and we're really excited about that. We've got, like I said, thousands and thousands of maps to start with, and that's going to grow exponentially over time, so stay tuned. As you get into the Antique Maps Viewer, we've got a subscription, we've clicked on that choice of viewers, and we are presented with this page. I want you to notice this blue bar along the top of the viewer here. This is where you'll do your typical browsing amongst the collection of maps that we have, and I want to click on this far left blue window or drop down to show you we have four broad categories of maps. The default category is going to be United States landowners. It's what we've really been known for up to this point, but we've got some other uses and other types of maps, and that's going to get into international maps later on. This is where you'll go to find really varying and new content, so always check this box for what's new and what's going on. So if we are in U.S. landowners, then we can click on the next box to get into states and then the particular maps within the state or the collection as you drill down. I'm going to, before I get into actually using the tool in terms of navigating in and around a particular map, I want to show you a couple other ways to get to some maps. One is to use this search maps box up here in the top left. If we type in, say, a county name or a name that would be within the map's title, a word, let's say Virginia. We'll do something simple here. Hit enter. We'll get a box opening with some choices here. As we click on them, we can get details, exact details about the resource and what we're going to be looking at. So that pulled West Virginia state map, a regular Virginia state map, and then it also pulled some landowner maps. Here's a Spotsylvania County, Virginia, Loudoun County, Virginia map, 1864, etc. So here's one with four or five counties in it, and so on. So that's how you'll pick maps, by searching the map name. I'll put another name in here, say Marion, just because I know that's a town name in this case. It comes from an Iowa 1875 statewide atlas This is a Marion County map from that same 1875 Iowa Atlas. But also there's a Marion Township in Hardin County, Kentucky, and a Marion County, Kentucky. I'm sorry, that first one, this one was Ohio. This one is Marion County, Kentucky, along with Washington County, Kentucky, from an 1877 map of landowners. That's pretty simple. So apart from that box, we've got the surname search box. And many of these maps are indexed. The ones that are not will be. And we'll talk about that more later. But we've got hundreds of thousands of names already in here. So I'll put a name. How about Schwartz? Name that comes up in one of my favorite movies I won't get into at the moment. But so the name Schwartz comes up. We've got six of them in Pennsylvania, three in Kansas, etc. I'm going to drill down here. We've got a Northampton County, Pennsylvania atlas, and that name Schwartz comes up in three different maps, and I'll just keep drilling down. When you finally get to the map in the drill down, you'll notice I'm going to close this window now. The name Schwartz was highlighted over here on the right in the map contents tab. Notice this, what we call the sidebar, has five options over here, or four, I'm sorry, options we'll talk about here in a moment. But one of them is the map contents. Depending on the types of content in the map, one of them would be owners, obviously. That's what we're kind of known for. But it might also be other features or towns or things like that as we improve our indexing with those kinds of things. But right now, it's primarily names. So the Schwartz in this map was highlighted. If I double-click on the name, it zooms right to it. If I use these buttons down here, this would flash the selected item. Again, zoom to the selected item. Along the left-hand side, notice I've got a fit map to window. That just means zoom out to the full extent of the map, which is kind of useful to see, well, where within the lower Nazareth Township is this A. Schwartz located, and we see they're down in the southwest corner. We could have zoomed in using our mouse. I'm clicking and dragging, and now I'm using a mouse wheel to zoom in. I could also use these buttons to zoom out and zoom in, or to zoom in. Also, you can just double click on a map on a particular point and it'll zoom in. Get it back on the Schwartz person down here, you can see them right there. So that's one way to get into a map, is to search by surname and drill down from there. Going on to more useful features in terms of saving your work and annotating your work, I want to pick a different map. Let's go to Kentucky. And the first map we've got for Kentucky is Barron County, 1879 landowner map, and courtesy of the Library of Congress. And you notice the little blue marker over here, and that is what we call that, as a custom marker, one that I put down earlier. To create one of those, you would use the push pin icon over here on the far left. Notice it says draw custom marker as I highlight over it. And if I click on it, it should give me a little bit of information. As I hover over it, it says Blue Springs Church, Barron County, Kentucky. And I've added a little information here. I said Reverend Ralph Petty began serving as pastor here in 1823. I could edit this marker, which I'm going to in a moment, or delete it, but I'm going to click off of it. Now I'm going to zoom in to that marker. Let's see what we're looking at here. We're right on the Metcalf Barron County line, and Reverend Ralph was an ancestor of my wife's, and was really excited to find this map. I spent a day looking for Reverend Ralph's burial place once upon a time, to no avail. And in that process, and after we returned home, did a little digging and found a description of the location. The one we had was wrong, but it described it to be at the point where this B. Hatchett property is, west here of the Blue Springs Church. With a little bit of investigation, I found that the Hatchett family still owned this farm, and I actually located a descendant who was a public servant working for the state of Kentucky, a very kind man, and has offered to give me a tour someday. But he informed me that the headstone had been destroyed, or they'd either been buried under or put in a barn. They were no longer standing. It was now a field, and that the cemetery was lost, what was one time the Petty Cemetery. What I want to do, though, is I want to, I'm very much a proponent of us perpetuating and persisting stories and facts that we know to be true, and documenting such things. So I'm going to create a marker for the Petty Cemetery. Now, I don't have the exact location, but it's in this general area, and I could even see this in my mind's eye as we drove back and forth up and down this road a few years ago. I'm going to mark this a cemetery. I'm going to put Petty Cemetery, and I'm going to put burial place of Reverend Ralph Petty, wife Isabella McClure Petty, and son-in-law William Wood Clack. Reverend Ralph and Isabella's daughter, Isabella Petty, married William Wood Clack. These are all my wife's ancestors. I'm going to save that. So now we've got another marker with the Petty Cemetery mark. I'm going to show you a couple things we can do to enhance these markers next time we want to look at them. You'll notice I have a couple of web pages open or in the other tabs back here. I'm going to make use of a couple of websites that I have found here in just a second. So I'm going to click back on this Blue Springs church marker, and I'm going to edit it. And one thing I can do here is I can add a web resource. So what that means, I can either add an image or a web page that I can then view the next time I come back to this marker without having to sniff around the internet. So I'm going to add a web resource. It's asking me for a URL, a uniform resource locator, basically a web page or web address. Now, as it turns out, I found a web page on Roots Web where this fine gentleman took the time to transcribe a portion of a book, I believe, some time back, that has a little miniature biography of Reverend Petty. So this is something I would want to link to. So I'm going to copy that URL. I'm right-clicking up here and clicking copy. Go back over here. I'm going to Control-V on a Windows machine. I'm going to verify it's a good URL. The fact that it didn't give me an error means it is. Then I can put a title in here for this resource. I'll put Reverend Petty Biography. Could put more information here, and might later. And save. So now, next time I come back to the Blue Springs Church marker, I can click on it. See, there are related web pages. There's the Reverend Petty Biography. And voila, we go right to it. So that's one good use of a marker. Another one, as I said before, I'm going to close that original page and open this one. This is an image of Reverend Petty's headstone before it was destroyed, taken by, I'm not sure who. I just found this the other day. But the owner of this website, someone I want to get in touch with, because we can definitely share some good information. But I've seen a bad copy of this photograph, actually just an old photocopy. But it's nice to see a good, good crisp image here, and I'm anxious to see if I can't get a larger one from the owner. It's really a nice one. So I want to add this image, though, to our other marker that was for the Petty Cemetery. So I'm going to right-click. I'm using Google Chrome. It allows you, all the browsers will let you do this. They'll just use a little different terminology. I can copy the image URL. Go back over here, go back into this marker, which is the Petty Cemetery, edit this marker, add a web resource. This time, instead of a web page, though, I'm going to put an actual image, a JPEG, in this case, image URL, verify, and notice a little thumbnail came up of the Ralph Petty grave. I'm going to rename that Ralph Petty Grave Photograph and attach that. And save. So next time I come to that, I've got a copy of the image here. I can click on it and it'll pull it up for me. Simple as that. So I have added a marker, edited an existing marker. Those are two very common things we can do. Notice the value of this map, though. I've told you about their Reverend Petty's son-in-law being William Wood Clack. William's mother was a Wood, and there are still Woods living in this area here in 1879. I see other names I cannot wait to further research, having just seen this map and just here recently, just recently acquired it. But I see names up and down the area here where that are mentioned in a travel journal that my wife Vicky's great-grandfather wrote down in a travel journal back in the 1920s when he returned here to his home country from West Texas and went and visited some of these families. And I'm really looking forward to correlating those names that he wrote down with people that are actually in this map. Really excited about that. So that'll be something else. I'll add those photographs to a website that I have and be able to link those to other markers, maybe referring to some of these people here in the map. I remember seeing this Pimbleton name, for instance. Excuse me. So those are markers. That's this little push pin icon and the different things we can do with that. Now this other icon right above that is the camera icon is one for taking snapshots. Where push pins are really for annotating, for adding new information, snapshots are really just for navigation purposes, helping me find locations whether or not I want to add new information to it. If, for instance, I was in another map and I wanted to somehow link it to this map, I would need to have a snapshot here. So it's a good idea anytime you find a good location on a map that you know you're going to want to come back to, either at the very least put down a marker, but do yourself a favor and go ahead and make a snapshot. Doesn't take but a moment, and I guarantee in a lot of cases it'll save you some time. So I'm going to go ahead and click on snapshot, and like I say, it's just a bookmark. And I'm going to put Blue Springs or Petty, or Ralph Petty area. East of Hinesville, Barron County, Kentucky. The reason I'm putting a little more in-depth title there is those are the words that I can search on later on. So I want to have a decent little description of this, caption for the snapshot. So includes the Petty Cemetery and Blue Springs Church. Right now we don't search on this level of metadata, but we can't. We will come up with that later. So more the merrier on information. So I've created a snapshot. So what? Let me show you where that would be if I wanted to use that. Better than that, let me use a different one. I know for a fact the Wood family and the Clack family and others that settled in this area came from an area west of Charlottesville, Virginia, around 1800. And they were at a particular area that I've already made a snapshot at. So I want to use the snapshots and go to that map and show you where they came from. They came from Israel's Gap, Albemarle County, Virginia. I could have started searching for Albemarle, and it would have taken me. I've got a couple of markers for that area. So Israel's Gap, Albemarle County, Virginia. I'm going to double click on that. It's warning me we're about to leave this map. And here we are. So you notice Israel's Gap in the center of the screen. Notice already some Wood family names up here. They were there in 1875, so they didn't all leave. The Wood family married into the Israel family. This Israel's Gap's named after Solomon Israel or his son Michael. People disagree on which one. It doesn't really matter. They were both here, and Solomon was my wife's ancestor and then descended from his daughter, Eleanor, who married the Wood. The Wood, who married the Clack, etc. So this is an important part point in my wife's family's history. It's also a beautiful area. If you ever get a chance to drive the area, I recommend it. Another thing that's just avid reader and was always a fan of Edgar Allan Poe. The only work that he ever wrote that had to do with Virginia, where he attended college at University of Virginia, he wrote a short story about the Ragged Mountains. And you notice Israel's Gap's right in the heart of the Ragged Mountains, which I thought was kind of a cool little connection there. I might put that in a marker later or do something with that, but what I want to do at the moment is I want to put a marker down here for Israel's gap. And just to show you, take another, I'm going to put home, because I know the Israel's lived here. Solomon, get my clacks mixed up with my Solomon, Israel, settled here in late 1700s. So I'll leave that for now. There will be a lot I can add to this later. That's the good thing about it. Just lay something down. You can always come back later. I did want to do one more thing. I didn't do it. Let's do it now. I'm going to click on back of the marker, edit the marker. Now, one of the things I did, two things we did earlier, added a web page and a web image using this button. This next button, I can add a snapshot. Well, what does that do? That allows you to jump from one map to another by just a couple of clicks. So I'm going to add a snapshot. And if you remember, I made one about the Petties over in Kentucky, so I just put Petty in there, found the right one, attached it, and save that. So now, next time we come to this page, we can go right to our marker, click related snapshots, see the one we just entered, and when I click view the snapshot, it'll ask, do we want to leave this map? Yes, we do. And there we are, back to the Barron County map and the location that we specified. You'll notice the markers are not showing that were there just moments ago. The reason is my default setting is to leave my markers turned off, or I turned them off earlier. I don't even remember which one applies here, but they are, for whatever reason, the markers are turned off. We can go back down to click on the markers link on the right sidebar, choose marker visibility options. Can either specify any combination of the various types of markers, or we can just say show all and they'll show back up. They will always show up when you enter one, no matter what your settings are, and that was what we were doing earlier. So the church one was turned on, place of worship, and I think I turned it off anyway. That's something that you can use. If you've got very few markers, then I'd leave them all on all the time. In some areas of some maps, it can get pretty cluttered pretty quickly, and you might get a little more specific with what you want. And moving beyond that, I told you earlier we would be getting into, I'd go back to the content, types of content that we've got in our Antique Maps project, and specifically that we had these four broad categories. And so the next one I want to point out is this one of the Cherokee allotments in Oklahoma,
and what is now northeastern part of the state. And this is a map of our creation, and as you zoom in a little closer, you can start to see what this is here, an index of Cherokee allotment maps. So this is an index map, an index for a bunch of maps, 230, I believe, 229. And there's a map per township, per 36 square mile area, using the township and range type of nomenclature. So if you know a township and range, you can go right to that. If you don't, here's where map contents can come in handy. If you know a town name, for instance, I'm going to use one. I'm going to cheat a little here. Here's a town called Uwala. I'm going to double click on that, and it takes me right there. I happen to know that there's a really famous person who has an allotment in this township here. These little crosshair icons, if you'll click on them, it'll take you directly to that Cherokee allotment map for Township 23 North, Range 16 East. I want to do that. And I'll turn my markers back on, because here's an interesting one. And you'll start to see the name come into focus there. It's William P. Rogers. That's William Penn Rogers, the infamous humorist and actor and cowboy, Will Rogers. This was his Cherokee allotment. And you can see I've attached some images of some documents that I've gotten from National Archives. Won't get into that right now, but you can attach whatever you want to. And I attached the Wikipedia page for Will Rogers, etc. But there's a wealth of information and a wealth of famous people that are going to be found in these maps that have been indexed separately, but never indexed in correlation with the maps. And we're about 20% of the way through. We feel like there's going to be about 90 to 100,000 people amongst these
230-odd townships, and I've already seen a number of other famous people among them, or at least the ancestors of famous people. Clement Rogers, just for history's sake here, is Will's father, and they also had two more little parcels up here. I've gone on to put other markers in our First Landowners map where the Will Rogers birth house is located, which is just about a mile west of here. This is all underwater nowadays. This is this was the Verdigris River. I guess it might still technically be, but this is all underwater now. The Ooligah Lake, I believe it is. So there's one of our broad categories apart from just general U.S. landowners. Another one is general maps and atlases. And you'll notice right off it might seem a little confusing. Here's one we shorthand entitled Pennsylvania and the World. It's really good, just a really good old Rand McNally atlas from 1911. It focused on Pennsylvania, and to that extent it added four maps for Pennsylvania, and then the rest of it was the same it would have been for any other state, with just really beautiful maps for each state in the Union, and also for each continent and some regional areas around the world. So there's a really nice map of Africa in 1911. similarly, there's one for Europe. And it's just, as a history buff, looking at political boundaries before World War I is always a fun thing to do, and see what how things were really split up back in those days. But also, you got really nice state maps, getting into Illinois, and seeing what communities were important in 1911, as opposed to here we are almost 100 years later. You'll notice a lot of county seats have changed in some states more than others. But it's just a nice way to go back in time and see if county lines perhaps changed, but also, you know, a lot of towns have come and gone. A lot of towns in Oklahoma I've noticed are now ghost towns that are in that map. But that's where we'll be putting general atlases that we find for Asia and Europe and all kinds of fun places that may or may not have landowners in them. And lastly, we've got United States rivers. This is only got two maps in it at present. I've got a couple of markers on there. That's a map, believe it or not. It's the ribbon map. Shows the entire extent of the Mississippi River. This was an 1866 steamboat river map they would hand to passengers on a little spool as they would travel up the river. And these little mile markers show the distances they've traveled from New Orleans as they travel toward the mouth up in Minnesota. We've indexed most of the communities and railroad terminals and a lot of other, not all of the landowners, but a lot of the features up and down forts and battle sites. If you look at map contents, you can find those real quickly. Islands, places of worship, there's one church, but railroad terminals, forts, like I mentioned earlier. We can go right to, say, Fort Harris, Tennessee, Fort Holt, Kentucky, which is right there at Cairo, Illinois, right across the line. And anyway, neat map, very neat. We'll have other maps represented, but the other Mississippi map we have at the moment is a pre-Civil War Natchez to New Orleans map. And this is a fun, really neat map. A beautiful map on top of everything else, showing you the French survey methods up and down the Mississippi and the plantation owners in that time period in 1858. This has been completely indexed. The map runs along the left half from Natchez down to Baton Rouge, and then this right half from Baton Rouge on down to New Orleans. I'm not an expert in Louisiana history, but I'm familiar with some famous families. One of them is, say, the Landry family. If we wanted to search here for Landrys in the map, I can type Landry in. Actually, it's easier to do that in the map contents. I'll put Landry here, and if I can spell. And we get a lot of Landrys come up, and I'm going to select those just holding clicking on one, shift key, and click on one down here. I can flash them. You can see they are all just south of Baton Rouge, between Baton Rouge and Louisiana. So that's just a quick and easy way to find out where the Landrys are. As we zoom in a little closer, we can start spotting them, which Landrys are where.
And so that's a very quick overview of our work with the Antique Maps Project. I hope you will join our many researchers in making use of this great tool. We'll have a lot of blog entries and a lot of other videos coming down the pike. And we thank you so much for joining us, and God bless.